Here's my stepper motor making these precise 180 degree turns. And well, you'd probably be pretty surprised to learn that I'm actually driving it off of this huge breadboard circuit. And well, you'd probably think that I was pretty insane. I mean, why make that when you could just use one of these tiny little PCB boards? And well, you'd be right. But this was an exercise in engineering. Somebody had to make the first stepper motor driver at some point. So, stick around, because in this video, I'll show you how stepper motors work and how you can drive them. So, without further ado, let's dive in. Here's the complete final schematic for reference so that you can follow along with the video. You can also find it in the description as well. Before we start making the driver, we first have to know how a stepper motor works. From the outside, we can see that there are four pins, but we can't really learn much more. That's why I disassembled this stepper motor so that we can get a better look inside. Just take the screws out and pry the top off to reveal what's inside. Already, we can see 8 coils in this large circle inside that almost looks like a big gear because of its teeth. This thing is called the rotor. The pieces that are attached to the coils are called the stators, and they have teeth as well. You may have noticed that my screwdriver was getting stuck on the rotor. This is because the rotor is actually a permanent magnet. The basic idea is that we'll pass current through the stator coils to magnetize the stator. Then, the rotor will follow the magnetic field. Now, there are 8 coils, but only 2 pairs of inputs. Why is that? Well, that's because all of the coils are grouped into 2 pairs, and each of those coils in each pair is electrically connected. This will make driving a bit easier since we only have to worry about driving 2 coils in total. In order to find out which pins correspond to a coil, use your multimeter and look for continuity. In my case, each pair was right next to each other. You can also use the resistance function to find out how many ohms the coil has internally. In my case, it was just 1.4 ohms. And to create that magnetic attraction, we can pulse the coil with some current, and you will see a tiny bit of movement. This is cool, but it's not the continuous movement that we are looking for. Instead, we'll need to start building our driver to see that. Let me explain the most basic form of driver, which is the full wave driving mode. And there are 4 steps. First, we're going to energize the first set of coils and form their magnetic fields. This will align the teeth of the rotor and the stator together. Then, we'll energize the second set of coils, and they will pull the rotor closer to their teeth. Then, we'll energize the first set of coils again, but in the opposite direction. This will invert the magnetic field, and thus create an opposite magnetic polarity. This will attract the teeth on the other side of the rotor, which have the opposite polarity of the top teeth. We will do the same for the second set of coils. And congrats, we now have continuous movement. Repeat these 4 steps, and you can move the coil as much as you want. And since it takes 4 movements to move 1 tooth, and we have 50 teeth, this results in 200 steps, with each step taking up 1.8 degrees. Okay, so now we've got the steps down. We just need to make the circuit that will do this all for us. The best place to start is the bidirectional current flow that we will need to supply each coil. This is where I will introduce the H-bridge. It gets its name because the circuit forms the shape of an H. Anyways, if we activate these opposing MOSFETs, then we can get current flow in one direction through the load. And if we activate the other pair of MOSFETs, then we'll get a current flow in the opposite direction, which is exactly what we need to perform our full wave driving. For the P-channel MOSFETs, I used the IRF5305, and for the N-channel, I used the IRL-Z44N. A nice part about these MOSFETs is that they come with the diodes built in, so we don't have to add any protection diodes against the inductive load. Since I plan on using a 5-volt microcontroller later on, I added these driving NPN transistors. This will also let me neatly pair the inputs together, with each pair requiring just a single high 5-volt input. If we use this resistor as the test load, you'll see that I can reverse the direction of the current by pushing either button. After I took out the resistor and replaced it with the first coil of the motor, we can now see the reverse magnetic fields in action. The first button press moves the rotor slightly. The second press, though, undoes the first since it is simply reversing the magnetic field. Cool, but we still need to address the second coil. So, I built the second H-bridge exactly like the first. Let's perform the full wave driving manually at first just to make sure that everything is working. The algorithm goes as follows. Forward current in the first coil, forward in the second, reverse in the first, and finally reverse in the second. It's a little choppy, but we can fix that with some computer control. I will use the Atmega 8A as my microcontroller for the rest of the project. Since the H-bridge runs off of 9 volts, I needed to add some regulation to get back down to 5 volts for the microcontroller. and I use an LM317 for that. Anyways, I did the routine PWM test to make sure that the microcontroller was working properly before I made the rest of the program. And you can already see that the internal RC oscillator isn't the most stable, and there's some serious time variation between the pulses. So, I figured that this 4 MHz crystal would fix that. So, I attached it in its supporting capacitors. I also had to change the fuses to activate the crystal. So, I programmed what I thought were the correct fuses, but accidentally ended up locking myself out. Luckily, I made this fuse resetter in a previous video, so it was really easy to reset the fuses. Anyway, here are the correct fuses that I ended up using. The lower fuse should be hexadecimal EF, and the upper fuse should be hexadecimal D9. Here's my implementation of the full wave driving method. And yes, it works well and moves very accurately. But there's still more that we can do. We can take this a step further and use full step driving. It has the same end result as full wave driving, but with the added benefit of increased torque. This is because two coils are always driving the rotor at the exact same time as opposed to just one. And here's the result of the full step driving mode, which basically looks the exact same as full wave. Anyways, we can start getting into more interesting methods of driving, which are all under the name of microstepping. The first and easiest is the half step mode. This is simply a combination of full wave and full step, and it will go in between each mode, so essentially doubling the number of steps from 200 all the way up to 400. But this is as far as we can go when we are using our constant voltage. So far, we've been supplying the coils with a single 9 volts. But a constant current would allow us to get far more precision. Let's aim for the next level, which would be quarter step mode. Quarter step mode would allow us to reach a resolution of 800 steps per rotation. Like I said, we need to create a constant current on the coil. I figured that I would take some inspiration from a buck converter video and create a PWM signal that would allow us to precisely adjust the coil's current. The first thing that I did was add a current sensing resistor of just 1 ohm. I chose 1 ohm since it would be easier to read the current, since there would be a 1-1 correlation between the voltage drop and the current. After that, I followed it up with an op-amp buffer that multiplied the voltage drop by 2. I then followed that with another op-amp that was meant to act as a comparator, with the other input being a triangle wave. And at this point, the circuit sort of worked, and I could adjust the current by adjusting the triangle wave's amplitude. But I noticed that there wasn't much PWM happening. So I took the triangle wave out and replaced it with a variable voltage from a potentiometer. And well, to say the least, that worked even better. So yes, I did not create a switch mode constant current, but rather a linear one. But the end result is still the same, so I consider this a success. This also made it much easier to drive with a microcontroller, since I could simply use a DAC to fine-tune the output current. I used the MCP4821 for this purpose. The only thing left to do was to digitally control which side of the H-bridge would get the output constant current. For that, I used this transistor setup where the microcontroller could pull the input down to ground. When I wanted to activate the input, it would simply stop driving the transistor, and then the op-amp could freely drive the H-bridge. Now we just have to write the code for our quarter step mode. While I was researching for this video, I read through the datasheet of the stepper motor driver IC, which was the A4988. If you go to page 17, you will find a table of currents needed for step sequencing. So, what I did was calculate what DAC values I would need to use to match what the table recommends for current draw. So, I made an algorithm that both coils could follow to hopefully allow for quarter stepping. The first attempt wasn't the smoothest, and there were a lot of oscillations. So, I used my oscilloscope to find out what was happening. It seemed like the problem was that the current values weren't the greatest for driving the motor. So, after some more adjustment, I was able to create a much better sequence of currents. And you can see that the stepper motor's movement is much smoother. And as a test of precision, I made it step through 800 times, which should be a full 360 degrees. And yes, it ended up exactly where it started, so a perfect circle. These 800 steps that we are getting from quarter step mode are really very precise, but you can take it even further if you want. On the same table, you'll also find a guide for both 8th step and 16th step modes if you are adventurous enough to take on that challenge. But for this video, quarter step will be good enough. Well, I think that we can all agree that using a stepper motor IC is much simpler in the end. If you've enjoyed this video up to this point, please consider subscribing so that you can see my future videos. Also, check out my Buy Me a Coffee page so that I can keep making these videos. Anyways, thanks for watching. Have a good one!